In section 3.2, we will discuss the method of images. Now, basically, what is a method of images? We consider one source charge, and then on a certain plane or in certain area, we considered an image of this charge. The image charge, the source charge, is usually a positive charge, and its image charge is a negative charge. That is our common understanding. Or if the source charge is negative charge, then its image charge, which we basically call the induced charge, which is not really there, but this image causes the existence of that charge, which in other words we call the induced charge. So if the source charge is positive, its image charge or its induced charge will be negative, and if the source charge is negative, the induced charge will be positive. So in section 3.2, we consider the 3.2.1, which is basically the classic problem of image charges, the classic problem of image charges, the classic image problem. Now in this, we consider that we are having our axes like this, like we are having our x and y axes. This is our x-axis, this is the y-axis, and this is the z-axis, such that the xy makes the plane of this geometry, while z-axis is the perpendicular to this plane. Let's say we are having a grounded conducting plane, and the plane is such that it is along the x-axis, so it will be something like this. The zigzag or the not a straight line here means that it is infinite on these sides, so it is an infinite plane, and we have a source charge, and the source charge is positive q here, which is at a distance d from the origin. This is the origin, and this charge is basically causing an induced charge in this conducting plane. The conducting plane is such that it is grounded, so the potential on this plane is zero. And induced charge is here. So the induced charge will be basically minus q here on this sheet, on this plane. Now we want to know that is the source charge is positive, so the induced charge is negative, and we don't know that how much charge is being induced there, or what is the distribution of charge on this sheet. To know this thing, we will use some geometry here, and to get idea of this thing, because when we measure the potential on this sheet, then the potential on this sheet is not only this thing that we have written earlier, V of R is 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught, and the source charge divided by the distance. So it is not equal to this one alone, because this is having some induced charge here, and the potential which will result in this region will be basically some contribution from here and some contribution from the negative charge, and that we are going to find out. So this is somehow a difficult thing to calculate, and we know some boundary conditions of this situation. The first boundary condition is that means or geometry is such that the potential is zero at z equals zero. When the z axis it's coming to the origin, then this plane, it is in the xy plane, so the potential is equal to zero when we are having z equal to zero, because it is a grounded sheet, grounded conducting sheet, and that's the reason that v is equal to zero. And another thing we know about this potential, that v goes to zero when we are having the this point, even if this point, this is exactly on the z axis, even if it is somewhere here or here, then this point will be we will consider in a 3D, and this is such that the potential goes to zero when x square plus y square plus z square is very very greater than d square. Like when it is here, when z square is very very greater than d square, then it is basically the potential goes to zero in one axis. But when we are having the this point anywhere here in this three dimensional space, then x square plus y square plus r square, if it is very very greater than d, then d square, then it will be the potential will go to zero. Now we don't know such function which follows these conditions, but the uniqueness theorem, as we have discussed in the first lecture, the uniqueness theorem says that del square v1 will be equal to del square v2, and that implies that v1 is equal to v2, means there will be only one solution. The value that we get of the potential, it will have a unique value, and this uniqueness theorem is basically compelling us to believe that there will be only one solution, or there will be only such function that will that we will measure here. It will have a unique value. There is no second value possible here. And to do to realize this thing, let's say we do some trick here, and the trick is that we consider a function that such that that function is following these two things. And let's say if that function, it then comes out to be following these, then we will say that it is the only function, or it is the only solution of the Laplace equation which is unique. So that's the reason that we are sure that there is no other solution, but only this solution we do have. So we just make equivalence of this configuration. And the equivalence of this configuration is that we consider the same axes, the same axes, x, y, and z axes, x, y, and z, and we consider the geometry such that the geometry is that we are having a source charge here q, and this axis will extend and it will go to the negative z axis, and here when this distance is d, exactly at the same distance d, we are having another charge which is basically minus q. We are Now considering completely different geometry, because here we don't know about minus Q, but here we are having two charges. There is no grounded conducting plane in between, and we are calculating the solution to the Laplace equation for this geometry. So here, when we consider it like this, is here this one is plus Q and this is minus Q, so I can write the potential will be basically the potential due to plus and the potential due to minus charge, and this I can write is equal to V of X, Y and Z, and this is equal to 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught I am taking is common, and then we are having the plus charge divided by R. So R I will write here that this is x square plus y square plus. Now if I look at Z, then Z distance is being subtracted by D because this is has already covered this much Z. So for a positive charge, I will write this as Z minus D whole squared. And this is under the square root. And plus, this will be, means for the negative charge, plus minus Q, because the charge, this charge is minus Q, divide by x square plus y square plus. And when I consider this one, then it is below Z, so Z minus minus D. Z minus minus D, and because this one is minus D basically, let me write here. So this becomes Z plus D, minus minus become plus, and this is squared, and the whole, this is square root, and we are having it like this. This I can written in a simple form is Q over 4 pi epsilon naught, and then I am having 1 over x square plus y square plus Z minus D whole square and square root minus 1 over x square plus y square plus Z plus D whole square and square root, and it's like this. Now we will see here that whether it is specifying these two boundary conditions. So look here, the first one, that V is equal to 0 when Z is 0. So look here, when Z is equal to 0, then we are having minus D whole square. Minus D whole square means D square. So this comes out to be X square plus Y square plus D square square root minus Z 0 D square. So X square plus Y square plus D square square root. So they both are cancelling. It means that our first condition is being satisfied. Now look at the second condition. The second condition is that V goes to 0 is x square plus y square plus z square plus y square plus z square. It is very, very greater than 0. So look here, greater than D here. So look here. When x square plus y square and z square is very, very greater than D, it means in the denominator here, we will have x square plus y square plus z square. This is very, very greater than D, so this will be negligible thing, and we will have this thing almost equal to z square. Similarly, this one, this will also be equal to z square, and when the denominator is basically more than the numerator, and it says that V will be declining, and then it will go to zero. Is this one is much greater than D. So it means that we have got such a function that these were the boundary conditions basically for this geometry. When there was one charge, source charge, and a grounded conducting sheet there, and we were having some boundary conditions for this one. But our geometry, which we just assume that it is equivalent to this one, comes out to be exactly equivalent to that geometry. Now, we don't care that whether from where this source charge is coming in, means this geometry is equivalent to this. But when we bring a positive charge close to a grounded conducting sheet, it will induce some charge there, and the potential will not be only this one. Like if this charge is only in a free space, and the potential that it is having this one, when the charge is close to a conducting sheet, a grounded conducting sheet, then its potential will not be equal to that thing. That potential will be compromised between plus Q and minus Q, the induced charge here. So we have basically done this thing. And now the question comes in that how much charge is being induced? And that is basically the topic of our next topic here, 3.2.2, and this is induced surface charge.